I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself flat on my face.
Well, I don't know, it's that some trivial thing, like she would crook about us not putting the clothes back on the thing. She knew we were getting counted twice. We were, and we weren't. And I don't know what it was. It was just some trivial thing that it couldn't have been anything. Anyway, it took her to the ball, and then it was on from after that. I think I said her every blaming day of the week, every minute of the day. It was sort of love at first sight. And Nancy, that's her sister's kids, Bruce Savage and Darren Savage, they used to come up and tease me, you know, like, oh, Eddie knows you, Eddie knows you. They were only 5 or 6 at the time. Oh, isn't it? Great. And we used to go out there a fair bit to their place, out to Denison. Oh, we went around a fair bit, and I used to quarter a fair bit because I used to get Searles' truck to take home, you know, so the truck was always parked in front of Frank Cross's she stayed at. She had a flat at Frank Cross's with the Colliers. They were great people. Did you know Frank Cross? He was a great man, and Jess, they lived there in Stores Street. And Frank was a shearer, and a header. He'd done a lot of heading out there for Thompson's. And Ethelyn and Anna had a room there with another room, a kitchenette, and the Colliers did too. And Frank had come home, he'd be as black as the ace of spades, and he'd lay on the couch, and Jess would be all over him, fussing around him. And yeah, one of the young crossers, the signwriters, he had his teeth in his pocket, and he always had throaties in his pocket, and he'd take them out, they were all covered in fur, and pop in his mouth. The kids pinched his false of his teeth one day and run around the house with Frank's teeth in. Oh, they reckon it was funny. Anyway, and I went to Melbourne, used to shear up at Hay, and when he went to Hay, they stopped in Melbourne one day and lost his little dog. He had a little dog. Well, they couldn't find him, and anyway, about 3 or 4 years later, they found the dog. You wouldn't believe it. Somebody had been trying to get rid of it, But he got a lot of heading around here. He was a brother of Crossy, the musician. So anyway, Nana was when I married it. Nana was lost, and after we were married, Nana was at wit's end. She'd go back to Tim Boone and she'd stay there. And she'd come back to Sales, she'd stay there, and she got a house in Pearson Street, and she was right there. And I'll never forget this. We'd go around and see Nana at night time. You're right now, Nana, and you just go out the door. Oh, no, she said, I'd like you to stay. So I have to go home a little prefect, 48 prefect, and put a double mattress on the top and bring it back and put it on the floor and stay for the night, see? Next morning, I'll be right tonight, so you put on a prefect and take it home again. The same thing, repeated. Should have had 2 mattresses, really. But a bloke by the name of Bill Feller, you know Bill Feller? He came with one of the auctioneers. When Bill came to sale, Nana took him in as a boarder. Well, she was made. She had something to cook for, she had something to look after, she was back in the living world again. Every bloody night, every day, we went somewhere. I just around the park most of the time. Up Stevenson Street was all box swords then. It was all from Newnham's, you know where Newnham's used to be? It was all box swords in there, it was all little parks, you know, like with so you could park it here, the box swords, oh, 1960, yeah. Yeah, Stevie Adams was married on the same day, and I took it converted to the Catholic, you know, the religion, and after many years, Father White came back to Sale. He took us for lessons, and he says, "Oh, he said you're still with him, Ethel. I thought you would have left him years ago." Well, another thing too, when I took it and they were great days. We went to the farm. They were great days. We used to play cards every Sunday night, and Mum would make a little sponge cake, half a dozen of those little round sponge cakes, cut the centre out, fill with cream, and put chocolate cake and icing on. We used to have Ted Bourke and Mack McCullock and Johnny Weightman and a few others. We used to play cards on a Sunday night. Well, you would not believe the noise we carried on, the arguments we had. We used to fight like Kilkenny cats. And after the when the supper time come, Mum brought out the cakes. One for Ted, one for Mac, one for Johnny, one for me, and one for somebody else who had half a dozen. And Dad used to go crook, we had cream in them, so we used to go get the cream off the milk. I tell you what I used to do. In the winter time, we couldn't have a bath in the house because we had bloody boil water. I used to bath in the wash-up tub across at the dairy. You know that little thing about that long, about that deep? Because there was nice hot water there. I think the hygienic part of it, they would die now. Anyway, we used to have to take the milk. Our personal, we had a horse out there called Dolly. And that was the horse that done all the, we had it hooked up the carts. He was a draft horse. And we had a horse called Peter. He was a round-up horse. Well, I can't ride a horse, but I'd be riding down the paddock with Peter, and he'd swerve that way to pick the cow up, and I'd go straight ahead of him. Flat on my chest. Anyway, one day I was riding him, and the saddle slipped right underneath. And here I am, my head touching the ground. Pete's up there, and I'm trying to open the gate. I'm saying, don't move, Pete, don't move. Anyway, he had pigs out there, and Mum used to help Dad at the dairy, and I used to take me holidays, let them go away in a caravan for holidays. But one time on a holiday, there was a cow sick down the paddock. I didn't know anything about caravans, you know, much about them. So I yanked up Pete, put a heap of bales of hay on the cart, and took a big tarp down, built a little room around him, and put the tarp across the cow to try and keep him warm, because it was a terrible day. And I didn't get back to the house, and the cow moved out of my little house I'm building, see, so I had to go back and go all over again. And he finished up, he came up near the house, because we had a big cypress trees there, and it was nice and warm. And we used to go out, Searles had a paddock out at Ben Ward, 100 acres out there. And a weekend we'd go out and with a trailer and get the wood for the week. And one day we saw this big black snake. Anyway, we couldn't find it after we looked for a while. We came home and unloaded the wood, and I went to work next day, took the kids into school or wherever we were taking them, and come home at lunchtime and parked the car out in front of the farm about from halfway across there, and come out, and this big black snake lying between that car and the hedge. And because I hate snakes, I went back and sang out to Mum and Dad, there's a snake out there. So Mum came out with a bloody broom trying to kill it. And it went into the wire netting and got caught in there, see. So Dad came out and got rid of it. And I took it to work, the Searles. Well, I got this big snake, I'd kill it, you know. So I didn't know what to do, so I threw it under the boiler. Well, you cannot believe the smell. I can still smell it, it's still inside. And Tommy Hackett come out, they're all outside the factory. Nobody's inside, they couldn't stand the smell. He's going to sack me, he's going to do everything. Oh, but that was one funny day. Oh, they were great times out the Mason in the 50s, yeah, they were great times. We used to have that Anzac Day bookmaker out there. Oh, I've still got the program for that too. Like the bookmakers and the count your chickens before you go home and all that sort of business. They were great days. That was Anzac Day. We had a big party out there, Anzac Day. All of us, Greg, Leo and myself and everybody, you know. Out at Mason's here on Boundary Road. Mason's, Leo Mason's, you know. Paddy Mason, the blacksmith. Oh, we used to go to the football. We took Paddy down in the car once, and we used to book in at the Rosedale Hotel going down so that we were supposed to be staying there. They'd put us in the book. So when we came home, we were house guests, you know. We were sleeping there that night. Never paid, never took a room. And they raided it one night. We had old Paddy Mason with us. And Gordon Martin came in, and Paddy said, "Oh, Gordon," he said, "I never thought I'd see you in a licensed premise after hours and all my life." So he's only raiding the place. And Mechanics Hall, and we used to go and get a few slurps in and go in and hop over the back fence and come out through the front like stupid. And old Gordon pinged us there. And then he knew we were getting in, so next time we got over, he whacked us. Oh, well, one day, about five or six of us, I don't know, they were great. We used to mock around big heaps. And anyways, going down the train just through, 4, 6, 8 years ago, and I was talking to Gordon, great policeman, And I said, Gordon, you remember when we used to get over the back fence? I still got that Woody in the garage at home. He said, you know, this is 50 years, 60 years later. I'd rather skip to the hole. But getting back to, we used to go up to the showgrounds, we didn't have any money, and fill up the big 44-gallon drums with water for the merry-go-rounds. And this particular year we were up there, we used to get free tickets. And we used to get under the tents and see them for nothing. And get in for nothing, go through a hole in the fence. And this particular year, the boxing troop were up there. So the bloke that runs the show, Sharman, I think his name is, he's sitting up there with his backside like that sticking out, see? So I said to one of the fellows, I said, you haven't got a pin, have you? So they said, they give me a pin. I stuck it in his pocket and he went straight into the tent like a bullet. Well, we went. Boxes come out everywhere. Alabama, they were big men. And we went, and I tell you what, you've seen that Roadrunner, and he, that was us. Anyway, that was a funny setup. The dancers, Mrs. Mary Bourbon, danced with her a lot. She taught me to dance, or helped teach me to dance. And we'd go up and ask the WASPs for dancers, and they would be only obliging to help, you know, like drag you around the floor, and eventually got onto the habit. And there was two dancers, there was a modern and old time. And it used to be packed, like, to be a heap of WAFs there, and a heap of RAFs and the locals. It was a big thing. And then the bishop built St. Mary's Hall. And what happened? We abandoned the mechanics hall. Everybody went to the St. Mary's Hall. That shut down.
I knew it was a mod, and old Tommy Cross was an old Tom.
And it used to be great. Oh, packed to the rafters. Packed to the rafters. There was one out here and one out there, base. And I tell you what, they used to leave this one here and get charged up at the Gippy, and they'd leave the one at West Sale and get charged up at the Hunt Club and meet at the Albion, the Bloodhouse. When we were kids, we used to go down and watch them. They used to fight like the Kilkenny cats. They used to, people be thrown everywhere, punches thrown. We thought it was great, you know. But we had a good time. We used to, the most famous part, we'd go to the pitches, and then we'd go around to the spot cafe and have a taste of tea. We thought that was great. Cup of tea with two slices of toast. Johnny, that's where, next to that laneway there, going up the back of the butchers up there. Oh, yeah, it was a great place and great food there. There was quite a lot of cafes and stuff. There was Sammy's up the far end, Sammy Costa. He put a terrific meal on. Terrific meal. And then there was a Silver Grill. He was a Greek or something. Then there was one there where the 74 is now. There's another cafe there. There was another cafe over there where Finlay and Weymouth is. That was always packed. It was only a little narrow gutted thing, and you had to queue up to get in there. And they opened a few around the town, but none took on like the Greeks or the Italians run them. They put out a good feed. Yeah, you can have a meal, but we didn't have enough money to buy probably toasted teas all we had, because we had a feed at home. Oh, after the pitches, that was a big thing. Wait for the Sporting Globe and the Herald. It used to come on a train. The Sporting Globe and the Herald used to come on a train, and we'd go get the Sporting Globe and the Herald and read it while we're having our cup of tea and toast. It's Saturday night, because it was after the footy, we get all the footy results, so you only had football season. And we used to pinch the fruit off all the trees around town hanging over, because I had this big basket. And we used to take all the pitches on Saturday night in the sixpennies, and the Glovers used to get up in there, and we used to throw all this fruit up at them. And old Ruth, we drove her mad. We drove her around the bend. We used to throw it at the screen. We used to put all walnuts down the aisle, so when we hear it coming, we got kicked out of the stacks of times. Don't you come back. Anyway, we used to put because you could see everything down the front. And the thing that annoyed me later on in life, the thing that I was so funny about, I was a fireman, I used to go on fire duty. And I used to say, oh, those bloody kids up the front, I wish they'd shut up, we can't hear what's going on. You know, like, totally different. And Ivan had to be on duty every time there was a meeting, a pitcher on. He's fully dressed with all his gear on and everything, with his tool, you know, his little spanners and, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they had a fireman on duty at the pitches all the time, and when I was in the fire, early fire brigade, a lot of times they'd turn, they'd sit right out in the back, they had no, you know, vision of what's going on. We always said a lot of free pitches. And I can always remember From Here to Eternity. It was a big movie at the time, really the top movie. And we queued up every night, couldn't get in. They were queued up from the two ticket boxes down to the Gippy, right around the corner on that one. And the last night, we were queuing up, and Ruth, we said, oh, gee, we're going to miss the pitches. Show, and Ruth said, well, you can come in, but you've got to sit on the steps. So we went in, there was hundreds sitting on the steps, you know, I don't know if it was a fire or like the trampling of the death. But upstairs, we sat upstairs on all those steps, two or three rows of steps. We seen the movie, and it was great. It was the best place that ever happened, and it was the most worst thing they ever done to pull it down. It was, because we used to go to the matinee on Saturday afternoon, and I remember Josie Howe. I can always remember Josie Howe when she first came to Sale. She's sitting on the steps, and she said who she was, and she married Kevin Howard. I see Josie a bit there. We used to knock around the Dyer girls a lot, and always sit up to sixpennies. Oh, it was great, great. Oh, yeah, Tommy Hackett used to get us to go up and work on his houses up there when he bought them in Menstown and at Lake Plainville. And this time, he said, don't bring anything, I'll cover you at lunch. So when we went there, he set the table and put a can of corned beef in front of us. That was our lunch. And then he had a boat up there, and he sent us up there to red lead the decks, you know, like with canvas and red lead. We were amateurs, but we'd done the job as far as he was concerned, on the cheap too. And this particular time he says, pull the pump out and bring it home with you, see. So we pull the pump out, but when we undo the screws, the water come in. He got a phone call the Monday morning, his boat's underwater. So he set us up the following week with plastic buckets to bail it out. And it's under the water, we're going to bail the bloody lake out to get the water out. He was a whacker, Tommy. He got us to paint up, and he painted his house up in Raymond Street. And I'll never forget Mrs. Hackett. I'll always remember this. She cooked us a meal up there. She cooked us sausages and mashed potatoes and that. At that time, I reckon I was the best stags and best potatoes I've ever had in my life. They were beautiful because we did work and painting all the morning. She came out and said the meal's ready. Oh, big crowds, good crowds. It was good, good. Everybody's saying, just the serenity singer Sunday night would all go. They'd play the piano and they'd have the thing up on the song up on the screen. Come along, little Johnny, we want to dance with you or something. And we'd all sing it and the music would go. We'd all try and keep, none of us would keep it in order, but we used to sing a lot. But yeah, packed to the rafters. He's, it's great days. I was just telling the young bloke up there that the first car I bought was a 29 Chev. I bought off Jimmy Johnson. I bought that in 1950. It cost me 160 quid, which is $320 today's money. And I had to have a, we used to put the hood down and layer ice in town, because in the summertime I never got out of my swimming togs. I went shopping my swimming togs, I went everywhere in my togs. That was summertime, and it wasn't a lot, you know, wouldn't do it today, but you'd go down the street, wear my togs all summertime, you know, I'd go up in the morning, put them on, that was it all day, regardless of what was going on. And I used to get burnt like bugger, I don't know, I didn't get cancer in the skin. Then I bought a 35 Chev off Leo Duffy. He was had the billiard room in Sale, big billiard room. There used to be a bloke, Harry Rogers used to work at the post office in them days, and Harry was cross-eyed. And he was sitting inside the billiard room door one night, and a rat bloke come in, and Harry said, would you like a game? And he says, yeah, I'll have a game. So Harry beat him. Anyway, he went out the drove, he says, as a bloke inside, he said, he beat me at snooker, he says, and he was looking out the door. It was cross-eyed. Oh, dear. 10 tables on there at Leo Duffy. And over where the Nobby is now, Leo, he had four tables there. Doc Loughlan, he used to be an SP bookmaker. There was four tables there. He didn't get much business, old Doc, because his daughter married Lex Glover.
Anyway, we used to go a lot to the brilliant room, the snooker room. We couldn't play much, but we used to think we were great.
We were down the back bashing balls and missing them and doing everything silly. Anyway, when I bought this car, I sold it. I had to have a new hood on it, so I sold it. 100 quid, they wanted to put a new hood on it, so I sold it for 100 quid. Then I bought a 38 share for £110, or Harley McIntyre. Then I bought another one for £50 because I wanted the spares. And I had about 12 or 14 cars at my time, you know, over a period of time, most of them bombs. When I married it, I think we had a, I forget what we had then, but we finished up with a 48 Prefect when Sue was born. And I remember she was born in Mapra, and the doctor rang up the doctor. I come home from work, she was hanging off me to come home from work, and he said, "Oh, just amble over, you know." So it was old Prefect, 48 Prefect, we go to Mapra, and Sue was born at some time in the morning, but I was home in bed at the time. I didn't go there because I was trying to get mini golf up off the ground. We had a mini golf course in Sale down there where Carmody's Motor is now. She was long black hair, you couldn't believe it. It was a Saturday morning, I went to see her. She was born at 7 o'clock in the morning. And I remember, you know, the black hair was the thing that got me, but now she's fair. I was terrific, fantastic. I thought I was a bloody king of the oil company. Well, yeah, we had, you know, she's like typical babies, like you had problems. She had a lot of trouble with tonsillitis, really. And they wouldn't, Dr. Pence here at the time, he wouldn't take her out.
What's that little street between York Street and Roman Street with a bond?
Gee, well, that's changed because there used to be big old buildings in there, like double story and triple story buildings, boarding houses. There was a skin store in there, and Mrs. Jack Lee's father had a shop in there doing up old carts and things like that. Oh yeah, that was a character. Oh, one time when I was building the house, they wanted £50 to build a toilet, and I knew that we were having a sewage put on, so I bought the one at the times of for £12, an old-fashioned one with a peak roof. So we went down and got it one Saturday morning and put it on the back of the truck and laid it out like that. So I stood up in Raven Street, you know, Saturday morning. It wasn't a crowd like now, but there's a few around, so I went up Raven Street saluting everybody. So I went up, stand up in the toilet. They were looking like stunned ghosts. What the bloody hell is going on here? Anyway, I got the tour over, and we had the nightman, and old Scottie was a nightman. He was a whacker. He lived up in Thompson Street. He was a real character. He used to go and tickle their little bottoms if they were still on the tour. At Searles Dry Cleaners, Billy Loveless was a nightman at the time. And we were all having our meal up after the tea, sitting against the wall up the Dry Cleaners. There was a big laneway. There was buildings there and buildings there. And Billy came out with the can on his shoulder, but she was a bit full. He tripped coming out and he cut himself covered. Oh, we all had to go inside, we couldn't stand it. Billy Loveless, he was great. Yeah, his father came here as a policeman.
After all these stories, I'll come back in another session and tell you some more about Sale, which I think you'll enjoy. Look, there's a lot, so you can't fit 83 years into 2 hours or an hour. And over and out, and I'll see you later or in a later life. Thank you. Over and out. Love you. That's it.
I said that's life.
That's life.
And as funny as it may seem, some people get their kicks stomping on a dream. But I don't let it get me down. 'Cause this fine old